Hello all, welcome to this, and we're going to talk some New Japan. We're going to talk a lot of New Japan, actually, because lots of stuff has gone on in New Japan, and to be honest, I haven't watched any WWE, and I can't remember when. You know, they're doing the ECW stuff, but I've seen pretty much, you know, most of it, so there's not much, you know, more that I really feel like I need to see as far as ECW, really. Anyways, you know, but anyways, you know, they're leading up to Survivor Series, and to be honest, it's like, really? This is the best you could do? And of course, they're giving it away for free, so of course, they don't really give a damn, and you can see that, and it's like, oh, well, we'll just give away a free show, and that's what it looks like. Anyways, about a week ago, what did New Japan do? New Japan gave us a little show called Power Struggle. And Power Struggle. And I saw it, and it was great. I recommend everybody going and watching it. It is basically sets up the Dome show, even though there'll be one more major show before the Dome. But that's never really that big of a deal. It's the end of the their tag team tournament. Which basically the winner of the tag team tournament will face the champions normally at the Dome. So there you go. And of course at the Dome this year, it's going to be here. They're going to air it in the United States. They're going to air it live, and then they're going to do a rebroadcast at like 8. And then also you're going to get Jim Ross as your commentator, one of your commentators. We don't know who the other commentator is going to be yet. A rumor is it might be Mike Tenay, which wouldn't be a bad thing, because Mike Tenay knows, you know, lots of Japanese stuff that Jim Ross even admits that he really doesn't know. So that could be good if that's kind of the rumor, because Mike Tenay, they're not able to announce it until Mike Tenay's TNA contract is actually done. Even though it looks like TNA may have found a TV deal, but Mike Tenay may just be done. You know, I mean, let's face it, being put on what a C-level Discovery Channel store, which channel store? Listen to me, Daryl. Are there even Discovery Channel stores still around? I don't think there are. Discovery Channel, that kind of says a lot about where you're going to be, but I guess TNA will still be able to have TV and be able to be on the UK, and if they can be on the UK, maybe they can go there 4 times a year and maybe still be able to make some semblance of money, maybe. Who knows? Anyways. Jeff Jarrett's global is going to be putting it on here in the United States. If you go to their YouTube channel, you have lots of info on it. Lots of the guys talking about, you know, Jim Ross calling their match, a lot of the American guys. And they've started kind of like, for example, they've started to explain like the Bullet Club. And they're up to, I think, then like part one, which kind of goes up to when AJ wins the title for the most part. So there we go. But anyways, this show was, as I said, really good. It set up the Tokyo Dome, which is New Japan's big show of the year. It's probably the second biggest show outside of WrestleMania, I would think. I think it's bigger than SummerSlam as far as usually attendance, or the Royal Rumble, but I'm not necessarily sure. But I'm pretty sure it is. But anyways, this is the big show. And that they're leading up to. So anyways, we had the dark match, which was Tiger Mask and Fugo taking on Masquerade Dorado and Bushi. This was good. They ran around, did a bunch of spots. Wasn't bad. It was a nice little spot fest, little intro show. So there you go. Then you had another little spot fest in the Young Bucks and Rocky Romero. Or the Young Bucks taking on Rocky Romero, Alex Kozlov, taking on Taka Michinoku and Desperado. This was a good little, the same kind of thing. You had, you know, Taka and Desperado doing their comedy. You had Romero and Kozlov doing kind of comedy. You had lots of spots. You had just lots of greatness going on in this match. It was really good. I would say it was really good. It was good. It was a little too spotty for my taste. Then you had Sakuraba and Yano taking on Suzuki and Azuka. This match was not very good, but it was basically just to set up, finally, Sakuraba taking on Suzuki. Sakuraba rolled up Suzuki, and so Suzuki challenged Sakuraba basically to a match could only end in knockout or submission. Match, because that's where they both started, and so we'll probably get lots of that sort of stuff. Then we had Jushin Liger taking on Chase Owens, in which he beat Chase Owens. This was good. It was much better than their, I would say much better. It was better than the last match, I would say. The fans, after when Liger won, actually made the NWA Junior Heavyweight title that he won seem like a big deal. We don't know. He should be defending the title at the Tokyo Dome. We don't really know who he's going to be defending it against, though. He did call out Muta, which that would be interesting, but couldn't even top the first match they ever had. That match is insane. If you've never seen that match, you need to go see it. That match is just nuts. But we'll see. Then we had a Carl Anderson, Doc Gallows, and Bad Luck Fale, and Yujiro taking on Makabe, Naito, Hanma, and Captain New Japan. This was pretty good. This match, they had teased there was going to be a new member of the Bullet Club. A lot of people were wondering, you know, would we get a turn by one of these guys? What was going on? Really didn't happen. Match was there. They went out there. They had, you know, they did what they did. So, you know. Then we had Red Dragon, Bobby Fish, and Kyle O'Reilly taking on Alex Shelley and Kushida, with Bobby Fish and Kyle O'Reilly winning, which at the time everyone was like, ooh, what are they going to do? Because no one was sure if ROH was going to let their guys be on the pay-per-view or not, because it wasn't their pay-per-view, but apparently that's all been settled. So it'll be Bobby Fish and Kyle O'Reilly who won this match, taking on in a four-way Alex Shelley and Kushida, the Young Bucks, and Rocky Romero and Alex Kozlov, which, you know, if that gets any sorts of time, that will just be all sorts of spot heavenly awesome, no doubt about that. Then you had Taguchi taking on Taichi. This was okay. I haven't been really enthralled with Taguchi's run as champion. However, at the end of the match, the Bullet Club did announce their new person to join the Bullet Club, which was Kenny Omega, which a lot of people were kind of they didn't want Kenny Omega to join it because, you know, it's the Bullet Club and he doesn't really need to join it. However, I will say this, he had a new look. The new look looked good. He did seem to kind of fit. A lot of people are kind of worried he's going to be like Prince Devitt 2.0. We'll see. Him as a junior champion should be interesting, so here we go. I mean, AJ Styles versus Yoshitatsu. This was very good. Yoshitatsu just you can tell there's still some WWE-ness with him still. And dude, you gotta tuck your head when you take a Styles clash. You can't be tucking your head when you take a Styles clash. Just can't be doing that. But anyways, this match was pretty good. It's set up. Had two sets up, basically, it looks like. As, you know, there was a big brawl afterwards. Jeff Jarrett interfered, and it looks like you're going to get AJ Styles versus Naito. Haven't announced that officially yet. And on the pay-per-view, which will be pretty good. I wouldn't say great, but it'll be pretty good. And then you're going to get, it looks like, Yoshitatsu and Hanma taking on Bad Luck Fale and Jeff Jarrett, which that'll be whatever it is. So there we go there. Then we had the match of the night, a match of the year contender. If you've heard about the show, this is why you've heard about the show, is this match. Ishii taking on Goto. This was fucking insane. This is the match that should have been at the Tokyo Dome, not the match that will be on the Tokyo Dome. No, we don't know. I mean, maybe that match will be crazy, but everyone had high expectations for this match, and they met them as it was just basically two dudes just going in there and saying, I'm a tougher motherfucker than you, and that's exactly what, you know, matches like this are. Just awesome. You know, this is the type of match that I can't wait to hear Jim Ross announce, because I Ishii match should just be a fascinating to hear him call. They set up afterwards, Ishii taking on Makabe at the Tokyo Dome, which that, again, at the very least, will be very, very good. So there you go for the NEVER Championship. Then you had a tag match. They had to go after that. I felt sorry for these guys. Tanahashi and Ibushi taking on Okada and Yoshihashi. This basically was just a setup. You know, this was like a tease for Tanahashi and Okada at the Dome. So really, what it was, still was very good. So there you go. Then you had the main event, which everyone had such high hopes for. Nakamura and Shibata. I don't know, something wasn't clicking. Just did not just work. Was still very good. I think people, the ending kind of felt like it came out of nowhere. Really, I think Shibata could have won here. I really do. Because, you know, unless you're going to, well, we'll see. Though after the match, Nakamura won. After the match, Kota Ibushi came out, and Ibushi challenged Nakamura for the Intercontinental Championship. So that will be on the card as well. So for Wrestle Kingdom, what we have so far, actually announced, like I said, you've got the four-way junior heavyweight tag team title match. You've got the junior heavyweight title match, Taguchi taking on Kenny Omega. You got the NEVER title match, Ishii taking on Makabe. You've got the IWF rules match, Sakuraba versus Suzuki, though I doubt it'll be a real, you know, the rules with it were kind of tough. This will probably be like streamlined rules for that. Nakamura versus Ibushi, and then, of course, Tanahashi versus Okada. Keep in mind, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 matches. We pretty much knew about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 matches. Basically, it would be like the equivalent of having 5 WrestleMania matches, the Raw after the Royal Rumble. That's basically what they would have done. And, of course, we don't get that, and so we'll be all hyped and ready for the Tokyo Dome, which, again, like I said, will be in the United States. I believe it's going to air in Canada as well on pay-per-view. Should be awesome. They also announced, and this will be kind of interesting to see, I think on December 1st, they're going to announce what this is. It's called New Japan World. And rumor is it's going to be a streaming service. We don't know exactly what kind of streaming service it'll be. Will it be like the network, or will it just be old stuff? Even if it's old stuff, there's some old stuff that I've always wanted to see from New Japan that I have never seen. I think my friend Brian has some of it. I don't think he has all of it, but I don't know. But it'll be interesting to see what this is. Maybe they're going to do away with Nico Nico, since you've had people outside of Japan that have tried to use Nico Nico, and are, maybe they're like, well, if people are willing to, you know, sign up on a site that they can't even read the instructions to, maybe, just maybe, we should start our own site and maybe stream our own pay-per-views from there. Just maybe. If that's the case, oh my God, I cannot wait. I cannot wait if that's the case. That's like high. It could just be, you know, streaming old stuff from New Japan's past. Even if that's the case, that'll be fucking awesome too. So they kind of announced that. And like I said, you've got all sorts of of Jarrett's promotion promoting this as well. And like I said, you've got Jim Ross. Which that should be really good. Jim Ross, in an interview with Dave Metzler, pretty much right after the announcement, talked about the fact that, you know, he is going to get some sort of say in whoever he's going to be working with. He's going to be there live. It's not going to be in a studio. He's going to be there live at the event, because he thinks that's that important. Listening to him talk about it on this interview, and listening to him whenever he's been asked about it before, you definitely tell this was something he wanted to do. He's not that familiar with the product, but he's watched the product enough to know that this is pretty much the type of wrestling he loves. He's going to be able to announce it like a sports announcer, not as a sports entertainment, you know, talking guy. So we'll see. I'm looking very forward to it, so hopefully when it's all said and done, looking just, you know, biggest problem is how much time are they going to give everything. It's very possible they could have up to like 13 matches on this show with 4 hours, and that's just not going to work. Even though, you know, you could do 12 show, you could do 12 if you gave, you know, each match 20 minutes of, you know, but that would include, walkouts and match time and after the, you know, all of that sort of stuff, which, you know, but anyways, we'll see. We'll see. Also, if just for those of you that don't want to listen to Jim Ross and you would like to order the pay-per-view, apparently if you hit the secondary language button on your little controller while you're watching the pay-per-view, you can listen to it in Japanese. So there you go. And I have friends that they're actually going to do that. So to each their own, I guess. But anyways, basically, none of you have any freaking... There is no reason why you shouldn't spend your money. Let me repeat that. Not watch the pay-per-view. Spend your money on the pay-per-view. You have AJ Styles on this pay-per-view. You have Jim Ross on this pay-per-view. We'll probably have other thing guys that most of you will enjoy on this pay-per-view. You know, I'm not going to start the you need to order this pay-per-view type stuff yet. But, yeah, you need to order this pay-per-view. Anyways, I'm out. Have a good one. Later.